Good evening, all. Luis Miguel Lexa from Brick BC Projects. Hope is all doing well. Yeah, another week, another show in terms of what we're up here in Australia in tokenizing real estate property. Yeah, look, we'll just wait a few minutes and allow people to, if you want to join us live on Twitter Space, it has been recorded also in video mode. So we'll be shared out to YouTube, our YouTube channel, and also in other parts of social media in terms of other audio places like Spotify and Anchor. So yeah, look, you'll see me look at my notes. There are just some things that I make sure I don't miss out. But yeah, you'll see me look at the Twitter space, my phone here in front of me. And so I try to engage. Obviously, our central point is very much Twitter space. But obviously, we also record the video version of it, so you can actually see, you can see my emotion and how passionate about tokenized real estate and real estate in general, actually. But obviously, the other tokenized kind. But yeah, look, in terms of reflecting on the past week, in terms of what we've been up to down here, sort of cover on that. Before we get to the formalities in terms of the structure that I like to keep to every week of our Brick Q&A. But yeah, there's some of the reflecting on the past week, what we've been up to. I've been always do my brick walks, either in terms of here in Brisbane or the Gold Coast, where our two properties have been tokenized. And what I do, obviously getting a bit of exercise, but also showcasing in terms of the areas that we actually are tokenizing. So I like to get out and about and be able to demonstrate some of the iconic spots around Brisbane and the Gold Coast. So you can see in terms of what is happening here at, in the areas where we are tokenizing real estate. So the areas are very much that we focus on, prestige areas, prestige estates, very much at the high end of the market. But the property is very much in the very niche in terms of where we like to position them in terms of the type of real estate that sort of sits in the sort of the 2.6 to 3.5 mil, the high threes in terms of US dollars. That's sort of the area, that's the areas where we like to focus on in terms of property cost price. Obviously, in these areas, there are much more expensive properties. There are sort of the 5 mils, 10 mils, 15 mils, 20 mils, sort of more up at the higher end of the of the scale, but again, we like to keep to a certain luxury, but to a certain niche in that particular target area of the market, in residential market. So, yeah, so in those brick walks, capturing last year's in terms of what happened in 2022 calendar year. So we actually put out some NFTs of the videos showcasing some of those brick walks last year. So we've done one on the Gold Coast. We've done one for Brisbane. So those are actually being tokenized on the Ravencoin blockchain as NFTs to be able for us to share around as part of showcasing some of these areas, and forever recorded on the blockchain. If you are listening live, if you join live, if you screenshot yourself in this Twitter space and basically comment and share that screenshot on here, I will make a note. Then we'll get you some of those NFTs that's been tokenized. Share around. In terms of also been sort of looking at some of the great content that Mark Fiddleman's been putting out. He actually sat down on his YouTube channel. He actually shared in terms of his sit down with Tron Black, who is the co-founder and co-lead developer and the president of the Ravencoin Foundation. So he sat down with Tron and fantastic interview, Mark. Shout out to you. Also shout out in terms of to your other interview, Mark, that you did with Doug Pape. Doug's also got some projects. He's actually involved on the Ravencoin Foundation board. So he participates and he also got his own projects. He's a practicing lawyer himself out of New York. So great interview with Doug. Always enjoyed Doug's views and his knowledge, and a great interview again in terms of sort of articulating the fundamentals of Ravencoin and some of the things, his projects. He's got his cold wallet coming out soon, so people can actually store their crypto and digital assets on that cold storage wallet that's soon to be released. So shout out to Doug. We'll make a start. So in terms of just coming back to some formalities, so my name is Luis Miguel Alexa. I'm the managing director and co-founder of RickBC Projects. We tokenized real estate properties in Australia, specifically focusing Brisbane and Gold Coast. And then next year we will add our last area, the Sunshine Coast, which is up north from here. So 100 kilometers north from Brisbane. So so they're the three geographical areas we're focusing on at the moment. We've got two properties. We've got the Koala property, which is a Brisbane property, and also the Gold Coast property, which is a Dolphin, as we call it, the Dolphin series. We stick to luxury real estate properties. As I said earlier, between the 2.6 mil to the high threes. Those amounts are moving up, but it's probably around in general these areas where we're tokenizing. There's been an increase around 30% in those property values. So again, it's a moving target. What we try to do is basically present the opportunity for people that will never have an opportunity in terms of investing in real estate property and traditional real estate property, given the barriers. Increasing barriers to build to buy real estate as investment properties, and I guess in terms of what we're doing here is providing people the opportunity, whether you're first starting or you're trying to accumulate more investment properties, and you can do it in a tokenized way in terms of fraction of a property, and get all those benefits that come in terms of being exposed to real estate through the tokenized real estate property. So again, in terms of today's topic, we're going to sort of be focusing on in terms of why property tokens, and again just sort of go through some of the problems and in terms of what is the solutions, and be able to sort of go deep a couple of things that I wanted to share with you. But so our current two properties that we've tokenized, the Koala property and the Dolphin property. So the Koala property and Dolphin, they're both at a cost of 2.6 million total. So people can buy tokens in those for $80 each. Again, this is in US dollars. Again, the Koala property, we're up to 1,243 tokens sold of the 33,000. The Dolphin property, which is the Gold Coast property, we're up to 3,265 tokens sold to date and of the 33,000. So we like to keep the numbers very simple. As far as number of tokens, there are very similar properties that we like to stick to. And obviously keeping the cost per token under $100 US each. You can buy one, you can buy many. So there's no sort of restrictions on minimums in terms of what you can buy. So, there's sort of a bit of an update in terms of what's happening with those two properties. Also, shout out to Michael, who's just joined us live. Thank you, sir, for joining and listening live. In terms of today's topic, why property tokens when you're investing into real estate? So, again, probably we'll sort of go back to the problem as to what problems are there. And I guess we sort of... look at the clunky banking system. Obviously, the banks have been in the spotlight of late for the wrong reasons. Obviously, with some of the collapses with Silicon Valley Bank, Signature over there in the US, and also obviously with the Credit Suisse, what's happened with Credit Suisse. So it's putting a bit of a jitters in the banking system. We know the banking system is clunky when it comes to traditional real estate. I actually pinned a tweet up here in terms of the second tweet, which during the week I actually Actually, it was actually this morning. Actually, shared some of the in terms of the issues that's happening with problems in terms of people actually trying to borrow funds or trying to get out of their position, because I know here in Australia we've got some problems with people that have borrowed money to buy real estate property, but they've been in fixed rates. Obviously, 2 years ago, money was cheap. Policy was obviously more loose when it come to borrowing funds from the bank, and so a lot of those people are actually coming now into where these fixed rates are going to variable rates, the honeymoon is over. So some of these are going, some of those cheap rates, fixed rates people have for 2 years, they were sort of 2.34%, at sort of the lowest point. Some of these people now coming into getting basically period of fixed rates over. They're coming into a 6 to 8% interest rate on these investment properties, which is obviously makes a huge difference in terms when it comes to the loan repayments each month. So either some of them obviously trying to refinance or try to refinance if they're on the front foot. But again, in terms of policy has changed completely over the last couple of years in terms of what the banks are looking at. I know in some places like the US, fixed rates, so once you've got a fixed rate, if you've got the fixed rate for 30 years, it's different in Australia. They only operate on a certain time. And very rarely do you see residential fixed rates going beyond 5 years. So it is obviously some differences in terms of different countries. And here in Australia, it's I never fixed a rate in my life when it comes to investment in property, because the payouts are substantial if you actually break a fixed loan. So unlike in some places like the US, I've had these conversations with my colleagues in the US who've been talking about this fixed rate arrangement with banks, and I know in the US obviously more competition, and typically a fixed loan is set for life for 30 years, and obviously that's different circumstances if you try to break it. There's no exit fees, and you know, when it comes to those some of those loans, fixed mortgage loans in the US. Some of the issues in terms of, with when you're borrowing funds, I know here in Australia now under the new regime in terms of as policy has changed, people are trying to buy traditional real estate. Some of these banks are looking for rental yields of 4.5%. Again, it's good luck if you get a property, a residential property. We're talking about obviously residential here. To have a gross rental yield of 5.5%, but that's what they're looking for. So in borrowing funds, they're now looking for 5.5% rental yields. Typically, if you're in a city, typically if you have a mortgage loan on residential, typically the yields are going to be at the good ones. You'd probably be around 3% on a good arrangement in terms of a good purchase. You bought well and you're getting good rents on it. It's 3% is actually sort of at the top. Banks, as I said, they're wanting 5.5, as you said, as I've seen in the article, they've pinned up. So they've articulated that in today's article in terms of what the banks are looking for. So again, it's the problems in terms of buying traditional real estate, is harder in terms of what the banks are looking for. And now it's, in terms of trying to get those sort of yields, gross yields, you start going to regional areas, you probably buy cheaper properties where you can still get some good rents. But again, some banks want lends to some at the moment. They're very selective in terms of lending to buying residential properties in regional areas. So again, it's a catch-22. And again, we start talking about serviceability of loans in terms under the obviously type of policy. Again, banks are looking to, in terms of when you're buying a residential property, they're testing people now at 9% interest rate here in Australia. So again, I'm sure there's sort of similar arrangements around the world where banks are not just testing in terms of what can you on the variable rate being offered. They're adding 2 or 3% on top of that in terms of how they're testing people, and in terms of can they service the loan based on the high interest rate by adding 2 or 3% to the variable rate being offered. So again, these are continual challenges in terms of traditional real estate. And again, it's and I think it'll continue to do so. Obviously, with increasing value, property values, it is becoming harder and harder for the everyday person to be able to purchase real estate. And again, they're just some of the examples that are things that are popping up here in Australia with from a bank's perspective. And I doubt around the world it's going to be very similar circumstances. So I guess in terms of what I'd like to ask in terms of, you know, and again, I'll ask you these questions. Have you tried to buy a property of late and you just get frustrated by the tight policy of banks, whether they're sort of looking at the serviceability where you can service a loan, or have you got enough equity to be able to offer them to buy the property? Again, it's sort of they're the sort of things that you know, it's frustrating in buying traditional real estate. Another thing in terms of, you know, have you sort of had an opportunity where you find a great property and basically, you know, it's going to be hard, and you say, you know what, we'll look at it next year, we'll buy next year. That's and then sort of come back next year and see that property's gone up by, you know, 10%, 20%. We've seen some of the cases here, 30%. Again, I've got a live example. There was a property that we were looking at to tokenize here to add to the fold. That property, you know, was sitting around last year, sort of beginning of last year, 2.2 mil. This is Australian dollars. And that property now is more like 2.8 mil. So it's had an increase of 600,000. So again, that's what I was saying. Some of these properties are increasing by 30% given some of the demands of property here in Brisbane. So again, it's frustrating because, you know, you sort of think, I wish I'd done it, you know, and sort of come back 12 months later and seeing that what's happening in terms of a substantial increase in that property value. Again, it was one of those frustrating things, no doubt some of you have experienced, and that's, you know, you spend a lot of time looking and doing the research on a property in terms of an investment property that that you've identified in a particular area that you want to buy. You do all the research, you talk to the agents, you put up with all the bullshit that the agents feed you. and I apologize if there's any real estate agents listening. But again, it's more the general that in terms of that frustration, and you spend a lot of time, and then finding out that that basically the bank won't lend you the money to buy that property after spending all that money, all that time. So it's frustrating. I'm talking about the everyday person. I mean, obviously, people are. I've got a great balance sheet or wealthy, they've got different circumstances, but I'm talking about the everyday person that basically tries to get ahead and try to build a real estate portfolio. Again, the thing is that, again, when buying also in terms of do you restrict yourself in terms of buying in the city where you're based, and obviously be only sort of having that available to you in terms of where you're buying. So again, it's obviously with tokenized real estate, it's a different story. We're talking about global, but in traditional real estate, you can sort of, because you don't want to stretch yourself, you sort of focus on the areas that you're used to, you know, inside out, and then be able to go out and actually see those properties. Again, it's a very sort of restricted way, but again, that's sort of all you know, I guess, in terms of trying to sort of stick to what you know in a traditional real estate way. And the thing on the other end, have you tried to sell a property? And again, it's trying to sell a property that where you've needed the funds now, but the timing is wrong, Given where the economy sits. And again, I think there's going to be a few people in some parts of the world that, given obviously some of these issues that are happening with banks tightening, people coming out of fixed rates, and some of them are going to be forced to sell their properties because, is it the right time to be selling? Everybody thinks the same, but especially at the lower end of the market, is it the right time to be selling these properties? And again, it's one of those things with things with traditional property. You can only buy a whole property, or you can only sell a whole property. You can't sell a half a property. So I guess in terms of always, is it the right timing to be selling a property when you need those funds? I know of, with some of my family members in the past who, they've come up to retirement age and they need the funds, but has been the wrong timing to be able to sell that property. But again, it's they need the funds, and they're prepared to actually take a lesser amount as opposed to being in a better market. But again, this is obviously the traditional real estate. You can sell a whole property, or you don't sell at all. You can't sell a part of a property. So again, they're the challenges in terms of traditional real estate. Another thing I also ask you in terms of, have you tried to buy a property in a month? Where you basically identify and the property becomes yours within a month, or a week, or a day, or an hour. Well, we know actually, obviously, in terms of tokenized real estate, you can actually have access to a property token within an hour, sometimes less than an hour. So, given obviously the ease and the liquidity and the flexibility to access tokenized real estate. So again, they're the things that in terms of we start talking about why tokenized real estate. And I guess just went through some of the clunkiness of traditional real estate, which can actually help people get ahead and start accumulating tokenized real estate. And I'll probably sort of reflect in terms of if a person's, say, example, a 25-year-old, you've got two options in terms of if you're starting your journey in real estate, accumulating a real estate property portfolio. And again, and I make a point, this is not financial advice. This is just general information, just trying to put some scenarios to so you can actually get some understanding in some of these fundamental things around real estate property and specifically around tokenized real estate. But if I'm a young person, I've just finished my studies and I've now sort of got my first job, been probably at it for a year or 2 years in my dream job, and starting to look in terms of, okay, well, I need to start building some wealth for the future. And then obviously in terms of real estate, it's always a good way to have that in terms of starting to accumulate your wealth, in especially where with real estate, it always makes, forms part of everybody's wealth portfolio, regardless in terms of whether you're starting out, you're in the middle of your life journey, or at the end of your journey in retirement. But there's always going to be some form of real estate, whether directly or indirectly, in that you're exposed to, whether it's super or insurance. Insurance funds that's in terms of pension funds that obviously invest in real estate themselves. So again, one way or another, everybody's exposed to real estate. But in terms of we start talking about direct exposure to real estate, you've got two options. Do nothing and wait 10 years, for example, and start then. And if you do nothing, you're at zero, you'll be at zero in terms of direct access to real estate in 10 years' time. So I guess that's the first option, is do nothing, and obviously have nothing to show for when it comes to real estate. Or you take the view, the second option, basically start to accumulate tokenized real estate. Or you're a 25-year-old, you haven't got the ability to actually buy a whole property, given obviously the issues that obviously we went through before, the problems with banks and the clunkiness and what have you. So I guess in terms of your second option, start sort of looking at tokenized real estate as to a way to start your journey, to have that exposure to real estate. And again, if we sort of use ours, when I talk about tokenized real estate, it could be, from our colleagues around the world that are tokenizing real estate. So obviously there's a great wave in terms of what's happening and between us and our colleagues who are doing it, US, Europe, and a lot of places around the world. But in terms of using ours as an example, just to articulate the case study here, say somebody starts the journey now and they sort of take the view, I'm going to start buying one property token a week at a cost of $80 in today's dollars, in today's value in terms of the property. I get to sort of the year, the end of the first year, and it's cost, you know, $4,160, and again, these are US dollars. So you've started the journey the first year, you've got 52 tokens to show for your journey so far. And the objective is obviously keep accumulating, keep hodling property tokens. You get to that, you say stay to the same principles, and you're buying one every week. You've worked out your budgets, and you can sort of spare in terms of buying that one property token every week that costs you $80. As the journey sort of keeps going, you sort of get the end of the 10 years, and you've worked out in terms of, you know, what you've now got 520 property tokens. It's cost you $96,000 in all those property tokens along the journey. And now you've realized, in terms of given the values of these properties that you've been buying into, even though actually that value is now $163,000 in value. And again, it's gone up 67,000 for what you bought for to along the way to where the value sits of those 520 property tokens. It's now sitting at 163,000. And again, it's one of those things with real estate is a long term thing, and just using this simple example, just buying one every week gets you to that value of $163,000 at the end of 10 years. In a very conservative way, though, we're always very conservative in terms of how we forecast our values for our properties. And again, this is basically buying consistently, keep hodling. But again, as we know, as along the journey, if there's some circumstances that you need to actually, whether there's an emergency, you've always got the ability to sell some tokens, because that's the beauty about tokenized real estate. Liquidity that comes with it, basically, you can sell one, you can sell 10, you can sell however many you want. And then sometimes, life takes you on the journey and the circumstances pop up and emergencies happen. And again, it's far much easier to sell one token than it is to sell one traditional real estate. Again, this is the beauty about tokenized real estate. It gives you flexibility, and you have various options of what you want to do on the journey of real estate. So again, just a little simple case study there that sort of showcase in terms of simplicity or starting to get exposure to real estate. And what we actually always like to make a point of, we don't see that that people should do away with traditional real estate. We see in terms of people that are accumulating traditional real estate, this is just tokenized real estate just complements their journey. If they've been accumulating, now they've actually got the ability to accumulate from properties around the world, tokens in properties from around the world. So basically diversifying in terms of your portfolio of real estate, that basically in a traditional way has never been able to be done, because obviously with the laws and across different countries, how things in terms of what things you can buy in countries and when it comes to real estate. So again, this is very much providing that it is a new frontier in terms of people to actually be able to start and also be able to diversify their portfolio by adding investment properties through tokenization in properties in other countries. So again, it is very much the new frontier when it comes to having a diversified world portfolio of properties. So that's the points I wanted to cover today in terms of why property tokens. And again, we tokenize our properties. We focus tokenizing our properties on the Ravencoin blockchain. It's easy. It's easy to use. And again, through our platform, Property Tokens platform, we provide these in terms of people to be able to access the new frontier of tokenized real estate. So, basically, that was the point I wanted to cover for today, our weekly show of Brick Q&A. Again, I'll open up for any questions from the audience. So if you'd like to ask questions, please ask for the mic and we'll give you the mic. I'm just having a look through any questions that come throughout the week. But I always like to prioritize people that do join us live to be able to ask any question while you come here making the time. Looking through the ones from last week, just having a look through some of the questions on the DMs here. Look, it's Oh, here's actually a question here in terms of from our perspective, in terms of tokenizing real estate, how do people actually buy our property tokens? People basically we use USDC stablecoin as a means for people to actually deposit and then and be able to buy our property tokens. So basically, people transfer the USDC stablecoin into obviously $80 for one token into our account through our platform, and they've got the instructions there on our platform what they got to do, and then basically once that's deposited, we then basically issue them with the property token into their wallet if they like. They can keep it on our platform. We can hold them custodian for them, or we can transfer them into their wallet. So with the Dolphin property, for example, people got the ability to front to basically we approve their wallet, their Ravencoin wallet, and we can then transfer that straight into their Ravencoin wallet, so they can actually hold it custodian their own Dolphin tokens, property tokens. So yeah, we at the moment we're also accepting Ravencoin. We're trying to add a few platforms in terms of merge platforms as to make a, having a few different options where people can actually pay for the property tokens. So but at the moment, yeah, USDC and also Ravencoin as the way to buy our property tokens. Again, it's we with it's at the moment. There's a couple that we basically going through the process of merge facilities for people to actually be able to use to pay and using any crypto in going forward to buy tokens. So again, there's obviously with the revolution of blockchain, different projects, people are coming up with different solutions, and we're seeing obviously a wave of new merch providers to be able to use for people to pay for things on the blockchain. So again, that's fantastic, and again with we keep sort of looking at always in terms of what's coming up, what's new platforms for people to use to pay for things, and we're always looking for ways to make it easy and provide various options. So again, hope that sort of answered your question in terms of in relation to how to pay for our property tokens. Yeah, look, if there's no questions from the audience, we'll start the wrap up. Also, before we start the wrap up, I wish to also thank SOS on-site musician. He has fantastic music. There's a song we played at the beginning of the show with the Gemini GM. Check out his stuff. We always enjoy his music. SOS on-site is based out of New York. Great variety of music that he has. I always enjoy listening to, and actually he's also actually mints his music as NFTs on the Ravencoin blockchain. So shout out to SOS on-site. Thank you for that fantastic music. Yeah, look, it's starting the wrap. Tomorrow we got a weekly show which is more generic around what is real estate tokenization, what is token, is the show that I host every week. It's more about it's not so much about BrickBC, it's about just our industry in general in terms of tokenizing real estate. So we like to have some special guests on and or open mics. But tomorrow, it's which is actually Wednesday, 9 p.m. US Eastern Standard Time or New York time, to have a focal time zone for people to see what's happening. The link's actually up already. But tomorrow we've actually got Mike. Mike actually does he on his podcast, Digital Asset Revolution. He actually has been interviewing for the last 12 months various co-founders, founders, leads of various blockchain projects, especially around asset tokenization. He's done a few interviews with people like myself who are tokenizing real estate. So tomorrow we're going to have Mike on, and he's going to share his journey over the past 12 months about what people are saying out there and what's happening, and getting a general feel in terms of from his reflections of his interviews on his podcast that he does, which is Digital Asset Revolution is his handle. And his podcast that he does on Spotify. We'll share that. We'll share the link to it. Fantastic interviews that he's done. Quite abroad. So looking forward to having a chat with Mike tomorrow on our Twitter space of what is real estate tokenization. So thank you so much for everybody for joining us. Thank you, Michael, for joining us live and listening in. Really appreciate it. Again, in terms of that NFT that I promised that people that join us live, I'll send me a DM of your Ravencoin wallet. If you haven't gone, go to Mango Farms and download your Ravencoin wallet, and I'll send you out a NFTs of our brick, my brick walks, in terms of showcasing Brisbane and the Gold Coast. So I hope you enjoyed that. So, but DM me if you haven't got a Ravencoin, just DM me and I'll send you a link to it so we can get you some of those NFTs. So again, thank you so much for joining us live. Thank you all. Stay safe. Have a great evening, great morning, great afternoon, depending what part of the world you're at. Same time, same place next week. Take care and bye for now.